Ableton has just announced the latest version of their music production software, Ableton Live 11. Live 11 is probably the biggest and most exciting update since I've been using Live. In this video, I'll cover absolutely everything that's new and why I think you should be pretty excited about it too. As of the release of this video, Live 11 is still in the beta phase, and I'll explain how you can get access at the end of the video. But for now, let's dive into what's new. Clips in Live can now be set to have a particular musical scale, chosen from 35 preset scale types. When a scale has been selected, the clip will highlight the notes of that scale using the color of the clip, with the root note indicated on the piano roll. By default, the piano roll will still show notes that aren't in the scale, but you can click the Fold to Scale button to only show notes within the scale. One of the things I see music producers struggle with the most is music theory and knowing which notes will sound good together. Keys and scales makes the process of programming chords and melodies infinitely easier. Even if your music theory knowledge is solid, the interface you get with a scale-enabled clip makes it much clearer to see which notes fit with your key and makes programming and editing MIDI much easier for everyone. Once you've set a scale in a clip, each new clip you create will default to the same scale type. But you can still set a separate scale on a per-clip basis as well. And for the music theory nerds out there, you can right-click on the piano roll within a clip to choose how Live displays sharps and flats, with different options to cover any situation and scale type. Push users will already be familiar with the different scale types available, and setting the scale within a clip will automatically set the corresponding scale on push and vice versa, even on a per-clip basis. I'm also really excited for what keys and scales opens up for future features. While it's not here yet, I can definitely imagine a future where it's possible to change the key of an entire song on the fly, much like we can already do with tempo. It is now possible to introduce various layers of chance and probability directly within MIDI clips in Live. Anyone who is already familiar with my channel knows that I'm more than a little obsessed with chance and randomness, so this might be one of my favorite new features. In fact, I've created a separate video that explores all the new chance and probability features in Live 11 in detail, including some creative ways you can use them in your music making. I'll include a link to that in the description, but I'll quickly summarize what's new here. There is a new probability editor for MIDI clips in addition to the velocity editor that you'll likely be familiar with. It can be toggled using the new buttons found at the bottom of the clip view. Here you can set the likelihood using a percentage value that a particular note will trigger. For example, if I set this to 50%, these notes will only play half of the time. This lets you create MIDI clips that have probability-based variations built in, so your clips can sound slightly different every time they're played. You'll also notice that the interface of the velocity handles has changed slightly. This is to better accommodate the new velocity range feature. You can command or control click and drag on the velocity handle of a note to set a range of velocities that the note will trigger within. Again, giving you an easy way of creating MIDI patterns that sound more dynamic. In addition to these, there are also new buttons in the clip view to randomize the velocity or probability values of a selected range of notes, which also gives you a quick way of adding dynamics to a programmed MIDI clip. Altogether, these new features let you easily create much more dynamic and interesting MIDI patterns with relatively little effort. You can now have up to 16 macros on any rack. I'm sure this has been a long-time feature request for many users, and it makes the already pretty awesome rack system even more powerful. This opens up a whole world of sound design opportunities, and I, for one, will most definitely be updating many of my own live packs and creating plenty of new ones using the additional 8 macros. Less obviously useful is the fact that you can now also have fewer than 8 macro controls. You can hide and show macro controls using the new plus and minus buttons under the macro toggle. This doesn't actually delete the macros, just hides them. I really like the way that racks look with less than 8 macros, and it makes racks that don't use all 8 macros much easier to work with. You'll also find a new button at the top of any rack that lets you quickly randomize the settings of all the rack's macro controls. Importantly, you can right-click on any macro and choose to exclude that macro from randomization for controls that you might not want to be randomized. You now also have access to macro variations. These save a recallable variation of the current macro settings. Click the New button to add a snapshot of the current settings. Then make some adjustments to the macros, and press New again to save another variation. You can then quickly toggle between the variations using each variation's play button. The variations can be renamed, and you can update each variation by clicking the Overwrite Macro Variation button. The uses for these macro variations are many. You could use them to quickly try out different settings for an effect, or switch between sounds in a live performance. I explore some fun ways you can use all these new macro features for creative sound design in a separate video I've made exploring all the new chance and randomness features in Live 11. There's a link to that in the description. Live 11 adds take recording and comping features that let you easily record multiple takes within a single track, and then quickly create comps of those takes. It works with both audio and MIDI. Ableton have really done a good job with this feature because it's pretty straightforward to use. Recording over an existing clip or using loop recording will automatically create new takes within that track. You can then quickly comp together the various takes by making a selection within a take and hitting enter, or by dragging on the edges of the active region within a take. You can quickly audition takes using the Audition Take Lane buttons. Each take is essentially treated like its own clip, meaning you can do everything you would expect with clips in Live. For example, changing its transposition, reversing, or even time stretching it. You can insert blank take lanes and load clips into them, meaning that you can also get creative with takes and use them as a way to slice up and combine different audio files in new and interesting ways. An important related feature to take recording is linked track editing. Select any number of tracks in Live and choose Link Track from the right-click menu. This will synchronize various actions across each of those tracks, including time selection, edits, record arming, fades, and take lanes, amongst others. The most obvious use for this is working with multi-track recordings. Linked track editing allows you to do phase-locked edits across multiple tracks, making it much easier to work with things like multi-mic drum kits, string sections, etc. Both take recording and linked track editing are really important steps in bringing Live closer to being the only DAW you need for any music making situation. I've previously resorted to other DAWs like Pro Tools if I needed to do something like record a drum kit, but these new features make it super simple to do all of that in Live, and means that you can combine multi-track recording with other powerful tools in Live like warping. Live now features MIDI Polyphonic Expression, or MPE support. MPE is a relatively new technology that allows the recording of much more expressive MIDI data. It brings electronic instruments much closer to the expressiveness of real acoustic instruments. MPE data can be recorded from a compatible device or drawn in directly to a clip, similar to how one might draw automation. So you can access the benefits of MPE even if you don't have an MPE controller. Clips now feature a dedicated expression editor where you can edit things like pitch, slide, pressure, velocity, and release velocity. The important distinction to make between MPE data and simple automation is that MPE is by definition polyphonic, meaning that you can record or program separate data for every single note. You can do per-note pitch bends or use things like slide and pressure to adjust parameters of the sound separately for individual notes. MPE is a little intimidating at first, but once you wrap your head around it, the sound design possibilities are pretty immense. MPE support has been added to Sampler, Sampler, and Wavetable, and there are a number of third-party plugins that support MPE as well. Live 11 adds a number of excellent new effects, and includes some great updates to existing ones. There's quite a lot to look at here, so I'll most likely make separate videos in the coming weeks to explore all of the new effects. Be sure to subscribe if you want to see those when they come out. Let's quickly summarize what's new. First up is Hybrid Reverb, which is a combination convolution and algorithmic reverb that sounds excellent. It's got tons of features, multiple algorithm modes, and flexible convolution settings. The various algorithmic modes remind me a lot of the popular Valhalla reverb plugins and are all excellent tools for creative sound design. For many, I imagine it will be an introduction to the awesome world of convolution reverb. There are two new spectral devices, spectral time and spectral resonators. Both effects use spectral FFT manipulation, which lets you process the frequency spectrum of your sounds in interesting ways and adds new areas of sound design that weren't previously possible with live. The chorus, flanger, and phaser devices have been replaced with two reworked devices called chorus ensemble and phaser flanger doubler. The new devices have all the features of the previous versions, but the interfaces make much more sense and are a lot easier to work with. They also add some really nice new features like the warmth control, which I absolutely love. Redux, Live's bit crusher effect, has also been updated with some new features and an all-important dry-wet control for a much more flexible sound degradation tool. There are also a host of new Macs for Live devices planned, but as of the release of this video, those haven't been added to the current beta. In addition to these new devices, there are also updated interfaces for electric, collision, tension, and corpus. The devices themselves have not changed, but the interfaces are now a little cleaner and easier to work with. Live 11 adds a new tempo following feature. Users of the BeatSeeker Max for Live device will be familiar with this concept. Essentially, Live can listen to an external sound source and try to set the tempo to follow the tempo of the external source. To be honest, this is my least favorite new feature, and it can be a little hit or miss. But it could be a useful tool for jamming with a live band or playing along to turntables or all the hardware that doesn't have MIDI sync. There have been some slight improvements to follow actions in Live 11. The layout of the follow action settings has been improved, and there's a new jump action. Most importantly, you can now link the follow action length to the length of the clip, meaning you can have follow actions occur at the end of the clip. This opens up a ton of possibilities for working with follow actions. There's a new create follow action chain command, which automatically creates a chain of follow actions on selected clips. You can also set the follow action time directly within the clip editor. Follow actions are one of Live's more advanced features, so you might not even be aware of them. But these new features are definitely highly requested, so I'm sure those of you who do work with follow actions will be pretty excited about them. There have been a number of improvements to the look and function of scenes in Live 11. Each scene has its own scene number display that stays consistent even when rearranging the order of the scenes. The names of new scenes will also default to empty. This makes a lot more sense than how scenes used to be named and numbered, and is also really important for working with the newly added scene follow actions. Yes, you can now add follow actions to scenes as well, not just clips. This makes a number of live performance setups much easier to deal with, and opens up some creative possibilities for sequencing with scenes. Lastly, the process of setting scene launch tempos and time signatures has changed a bit. Scene launch tempos and time signatures let you set a tempo or time signature for Live to change to when a scene is launched, so you can move between different tempos and time signatures within a single piece. This was kind of a hidden feature before that many people didn't even know existed, so the new interface makes these much easier to discover and use. There have been some improvements to the way things are organized in Live's browser. There's now a dedicated category for grooves, which makes them a bit easier to access, as well as a category for the new templates feature. More on that in a moment. Inside the audio effect category, you'll notice that audio effects are now grouped into folders based on their function. This should make Live's library of effects much more approachable for beginners, and much easier for advanced users to navigate and find the right effect. Live's built-in Macs for Live devices also now appear directly in the Instruments, Audio Effects, and MIDI Effects categories. This is another great step towards making Macs for Live feel much more integrated with Live, and will expose a whole range of users to devices they might not have previously known existed. Live 11 adds greatly improved template and default set features. Many people might not know that template sets have actually existed in Live for quite a while, but they involved creating a custom folder with a specific name in the user library, and it was all a bit advanced to set up. Now, there is a dedicated templates category that you'll find in the browser. You can save Live sets as templates from the file menu. A A default set, the set that loads up when you create a new blank session, can be created by going to the File menu or by right-clicking on any template and choosing Set Default Live Set. Templates are a great workflow improvement as they allow you to save pre-configured live sets to get you started quickly. For example, you might have different templates for different genres, or perhaps you could have one template for film scoring and one for music production or sound design. The interface of the clip detail view has been updated slightly, and overall it looks a bit tidier, making it easier to navigate. There are new tabs at the top to switch between different modes, including the new expression editor. You can also now double-click on the clip view's header to minimize it, which looks pretty cool and gives you a bit more space to work with. In addition to some overall improvements in the clip detail view, there are also some refinements to clip and multi-clip editing. When multi-clip editing, all of the clip controls are now visible, where previously only a few were visible. You can select and edit multiple clip loops simultaneously. A new focus mode toggle lets you switch between focusing on editing multiple clips at once or just a single focused clip. A new draw mode with pitch lock setting in Live's preferences lets you switch between pitch locked drawing, which lets you click and drag to draw single notes according to the current grid division, or melodic drawing, which lets you click and drag to draw melodic phrases. This functionality can be toggled while drawing by holding down the Alt key. Now, I'm not joking when I say that this next feature is probably my favorite new feature. A new toggle in the session view lets you show or hide meters that indicate how much CPU usage is coming from each individual track. It makes it super easy to pinpoint exactly which tracks are using the most processing power if your computer is running out of juice. For people with older computers like myself, this is an absolute godsend, letting you quickly find tracks that are slowing everything down so you can freeze them or switch out some effects. There's also an improved CPU display in the top right of the interface that now shows both current and average CPU usage across your set. That's most of the major features out of the way, so we're onto some smaller refinements now. There are a number of interface improvements across Live that make it a little more pleasant to look at and work with. There are also new Live 11 themes, including some great dark themes, which I'm loving for their ease on the eyes in long production sessions. There are new create crossfade commands for quickly creating crossfades at the edges of audio clips. You can create fade-ins, fade-outs, and crossfades. Or select across multiple clips and create crossfades on clip edges. Live 11 will also include a host of excellent new sound content, including a collaboration with Spitfire Audio. As of the release of this video, the new content is not yet available, but should be added before the official release. It's also worth mentioning that there aren't any major additions to Push or Push 2, but all of Live's new features translate well to Push, for example, being able to access all 16 macros in a rack or choosing the key of a clip. And that's it. That pretty much covers every single new thing in Live 11 as of the release of this video. As this is released, Live 11 will be going into the open beta phase. This is similar to how Ableton handled the release of Live 10. All the information you need about joining up to the beta program to give Live 11 a try can be found on the Ableton website. I'll include a link in the description. So, what's your favorite new feature in Live 11? Drop a comment below to let me know. Also, feel free to ask questions about specific features, and I'll do my best to answer them with what I know. As usual, please hit the like button and subscribe, and head to elephant.io to find more Ableton Live tutorials, live packs, and plenty of other great Ableton resources. This has been Tom from Elephant. Thanks for watching.